So in a conventional PCR, you have genomic DNA from which amplification occurs. For example, so this is the extracted DNA or RNA, which you have converted into cDNA, from which your specific set of primers, say forward primer and reverse primer, are going to bind along with master mix and everything else, tag polymerase, DNTP, magnesium chloride, buffer and nucleus free water, and you are going to get this as a product. Now in case of nested PCR, what happens? In case of nested PCR, just explain that. Now, like in this case, you could see this part. So, the product which we get from first PCR, this will be utilized for a second PCR. So what is the difference between conventional and nested PCR? You are not going to use directly the genomic DNA or RNA as your template, but you are going to use PCR product of first PCR as a template, and again you will have set of primers which are specific to this PCR product and not to the genomic DNA, and they will amplify the inner part whichever is required out of that whole exon. Got this point? Got the difference between conventional and nested PCR? Please let me know. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So that is a nested PCR. Now we will talk about hot start PCR. Any idea about hot start PCR? So it is a technique which involves our regular PCR, except that your tag polymerase is added. It is going to get heated at a particular temperature. So why it is that? So in this case of PCR, your tag polymerase is bound to antibodies, okay, and it is not going to work at the room temperature. So in that case, you need to increase the denaturation time or a melting temperature, and this avoids binding of tag polymerase at RT to non-specific template. So basically your initial denaturation time, you are going to increase in your PCR cycle, say instead of 2 minutes, you will not keep it at 2 minutes, your initial denaturation becomes 5 minutes, and then that you are going to use the polymerase which is a bound to antibodies, and that is a hot start PCR. So this kind of PCR will avoid non-specific binding of your tag polymerase, which generally occurs at room temperature also. And this is how this is going to work as a hot start PCR, and that's why the name is given as a hot start. Now we will talk about next part, degenerate PCR. What is a degenerate PCR? It is a PCR variant in which you amplify unknown sequence of a DNA related to a known sequence. So degenerated primers are used and they amplify orthologous gene. So for orthologous amplification, the kind of PCR which you are going to use are like, it is called as degenerate PCR. So it amplifies unknown sequences of a DNA related to known sequences, and the primers are designed on the basis of known sequences of homologous gene. Okay, understood this part? So what, how this technique helps? It helps it by allowing identification of a new member of a gene family or orthologous gene from a different organism. So what is the basic principle behind degenerate PCR? You use a set of primer which are specific to known sequence, and you use this set of primer to amplify unknown sequence. So obviously, if your primers, known sequence primers, are going to bind this unknown sequence and they are giving out some product, so obviously this gene and this unknown gene are orthologous in nature, and that is how you can find it out. So this is the principle behind degenerate PCR. Now moving on to the next part, inverse PCR. What is the inverse PCR? When conventional PCR requires your primer for both ends, inverse PCR allows amplification of DNA with only one known sequence. So what is the meaning of that? This sequence requires a restriction digestion and ligation, which results in formation of loop DNA, which can further be primed from a section. So I will just explain you that. For example, so this is unknown DNA and this rainbow color is known DNA. Now what you do, this undergoes restriction enzyme digestion, okay, and then you receive products of known and unknown, known and unknown fragments. Now they will go under self ligation. And again, you will have many fragments with known, unknown. Known, unknown, and known region. So this is your inverse PCR. Now moving on to the next part, multiplex PCR. what is a multiplex PCR? So for example, you have one gene. You have next gene. You have third gene. Fourth gene. So what do you understand by multiplex PCR? By this diagram, can you make any implication? What could be the outcome? So what we do generally in a multiplex PCR, for example, you have four genes. So obviously those four genes will be amplified by different set of primers. So all these primers are different, and obviously like forward and reverse set of primers are different, and obviously product size is also different. So you have a PCR tube in which you have a genomic DNA, you have this 1, 2, 3, 4 set of primers, and concentration of primer is also different. And obviously the amplified product size, say this will be of say 150 base pair, this could be of say 250 base pair, this region could be of say 300 base pair, and this is say 500 base pair. So obviously the amplified product size is also different, and what you will do, you will perform a multiplex PCR, and after that you will run it on the gel by agar gel electrophoresis. Obviously when you are running it on the gel, you are going to get one band. Like if this is going to be your ladder, for example, so this is your well number one and it has a ladder, and this is your well number two and it has your product of interest. So for example, this is one band. This is another band. This is one more band. This is one more band. So if you compare with the ladder, then if multiplex PCR has worked, so on the gel, you are going to get bands of various sizes. Obviously, they are not going to have various colors, unless and until you are using it for a SDS page. So in that you have a like amplification of the ladder or bands on the basis of using various dyes of a molecular weight which binds to a particular molecular weight. But this is H, so this is not available in the horizontal gel electrophoresis, remember that. So obviously, so on the gel you are going to get one band of say 150, okay, one band of 250 as the color I am indicating over here, okay, that color band I have shown. The next band is of say 300 base pair, and the fourth band was of 500 base pair. So like this, if you compare with the ladder, if this band corresponds to 500 base pair, then obviously this and this band is exactly matching. So obviously the amplified product band is also 500. That is how we interpret. If this band is corresponding to 300 base pair, if this band and this band is matching from the ladder and your sample, then obviously the amplified product size is 300 base pair. If this band and this band is corresponding to 250, then amplified product size is 250. And obviously the this band and this band is matching, amplified product size is 150 base pair. Then your multiplex PCR has worked and all the bands have appeared. So this is the multiplex PCR. So what is the main difference between conventional and multiplex PCR? So if I wanted to detect four different genes in a single set of PCR, or I want to detect multiple exons and mutations in multiple exons, so in that case I needed to run four PCRs at that time if the conventional PCR method was followed, and for every single time I will have to run the gel. Excuse me for a moment. Sorry. So I need to run the gel for a four different set of exons or genes which I want to amplify, and I will have to run the PCR for that separately and gel for that separately. So instead of that, multiplex PCR makes my work very easy. It allows me to add all the primers simultaneously and amplification of that. So obviously you will need to standardize this part along with the master mix preparation and addition of primers, and what should be the concentration, how to design, because obviously as you could see, there is a difference of almost at least 50 base pair between 250 and 300, and more than 100 base pair between 150 and 250 base pair product, and 200 base pair difference between 300 third and fourth product. So this should be maintained. And that is why, because when you are running it on the gel, you are not going to see that with that much of difference. When you take the picture of that and compare it on your computer screen, then over in the computer screen you can zoom in and zoom out, okay? But when you are actually looking at the gel itself, you can't hardly, like, you hardly make any difference between band 1 and band 2 if you are not used to it, or your ladder is not proper, or your staining has not worked. So these many complications are there when you are doing it. So this kind of work we can do multiplexing PCR, okay? The example for multiplexing PCR, if, like, for example, if you want to detect dystrophin gene, okay, which has so many proteins you can detect. So in the genetics we use, in the cancer we use multiplex PCR, in the diagnosis we use multiplex PCR. For example, if you want to detect for NS1 antigen and IgG IgM, if you want to detect Plasmodium vivax and falciparum and oviparum, so in that case you can use multiplex PCR for malaria. So if you want to detect rabies virus, so in that case the earlier example of nested PCR which I have explained over here, so in nested PCR the example is rabies virus, we can use rabies virus detection. So outer part is detected and the inner part which is detected in the rabies virus is the glycoprotein. So outer part is in general nucleoprotein of polyviridae nucleoprotein family, and inner part is glycoprotein of rabies virus. So that is how you can detect using nested PCR. That is the actual example. And over here, multiplex PCR. By using multiplex PCR, you can also do deletion, mutation and polymorphism, and single nucleotide polymorphism detection. So these many things you can do by using multiplex PCR. Now next part, moving on to touchdown PCR. So what is a touchdown PCR? So basically in early steps of PCR cycle at high temperature, with subsequent cycles, aniline temperature are decreased, and that allows specific primer to anneal at the highest temperature. So that is least permissible for binding of non-specific target, and it generates only sequence of interest. So what we do generally in the touchdown PCR, So, like, we are going to reduce annealing temperature. For example, we started our cycle at 95 degrees Celsius of denaturation. Then, first annealing we are allowed to do at the 58 degrees Celsius, for example, and the cycle is, say, 94, 58, 72. So this is 30 second, this is 30 second, this is 30 second. Then the next cycle is, say, 10 degrees Celsius than this. So next cycle of 20. So these are, say, for example, 20 cycles. Then this 48 degrees Celsius is again 94, 30, 72 degrees Celsius for, say, 30 seconds again. This will be of, say, 10 cycles. Then the last cycle is 94, 72, 4 degree. Okay. This will be final cycle. Okay, and this will be the single cycle we will have. So as you could see, at every single time you are reducing the annealing temperature by 10 degree over here, approximately in these two cycles, then you are allowing your primers to bind a specific target only, and it is not going to bind any random target. And that is how the kind of PCR which you use in this case is a touchdown PCR. So far, any doubt? Any doubt you have till now? These are the types and applications of the conventional PCR which I am discussing right now with you. Please let me know if you haven't understood any part, or if I should repeat something, or I should explain something. Now, reverse transcriptase PCR. So reverse transcriptase PCR is just conversion of your RNA to cDNA, and it is generally used so that your DNA is more stable than your your complemented DNA is more stable than the RNA, and over the period of time RNA is going to get degraded. So even if you store it at minus 80 degrees Celsius, then also RNA material is not going to survive beyond 6 months or 8 months, and you are not going to get your results after 6 or 8 months. So it's better to have a complementary DNA of the RNA, and that's why reverse transcriptase is extensively used. So you convert your RNA into complementary DNA and then you perform the PCR. Now, first retroviral reverse transcriptase was avian myeloblast virus, AMV virus. It has a reverse transcriptase which was used for the first time. And from where reverse transcriptase biology has started. So, this occurred in somewhere around 1970, and it was isolated by David Baltimore. And it was from two RNA tumor viruses. One of that was Rose sarcoma virus, and the another one was this murine leukemia virus. So that was a reverse transcriptase. Now there are two methods in reverse transcriptase, so we will just see that. One step reverse transcriptase PCR and two step reverse transcriptase PCR. So what happens in one step reverse transcriptase PCR? You have a mRNA. That mRNA will be converted into cDNA, the first strand, and then it will undergo polymerization by PCR, by polymerase and set of primer. And so on. So that is a one step PCR. Now in case of two step RT-PCR or reverse transcriptase PCR, first your mRNA will be converted into cDNA. Okay, now you are going to use the first strand of that. You can store this cDNA also. Whenever you want to perform your PCR, you can perform that. So this is a single tube reaction. So basically everything occurs in a single tube. In that case, this occurs in two tubes, two separate tubes. Okay, so what you do? You amplify your RNA to cDNA. Okay, then you add your cDNA in a fresh tube. Over there you add master mix and specific primers. And tag polymerase, obviously, or a polymerase, suitable polymerase, and you perform. So that is a two-step reverse transcriptase PCR. Now, what would be the advantage in this? Like I have said, I have mentioned earlier, in this, the cDNA you can store at minus 80 for quite long time, say 2 to 3 years at least, but avoid freeze thawing more than 25 times, or make that in a smaller aliquots, say of 25 or 30 microliters. Okay, and in this case you are not going to get this cDNA part. So if any of your reaction is not working out, your primers are not specific, or your primers are not giving you proper result, then you may not have the existing RNA which was the starting material. So that is a disadvantage with the one step RT-PCR. So your existing material may not be available to run the different set of reactions, which is not the case with the two-step reverse transcriptase PCR. Okay, so I guess, I hope you people have understood what is the difference and what are the types we have discussed so far with the reverse transcriptase PCR. Okay, so now moving on to the real-time PCR now. So have you people seen any real-time PCR?
No, sir.
No,
sir. Okay. Okay. So this is the QuantStudio 5. Okay, so I am showing this only model. It's not like I'm promoting this company or something, but I'm actually using this. Okay, so this is a QuantStudio 5. Okay, so this PCR like over here you could say, if possible, this is the tray. Okay, so this comes out when you press a button over here on the top. Okay, and then the tray will come out, and like 96 well plate. Okay, you have a plate for that, and you place the number of strips which you want to amplify in that. So for example, like this is 384 well plate reaction. We also have a 96 well plate reaction, and we also have lower end model is a 48 well plate reactions. So this is from Thermo Scientific, and the model is Applied Biosystems Quant Studio 5. So as the name suggests, 5, this 5 represents, you could at least use it has a limit of detection of up to at least 5 fluorescent dyes it can detect simultaneously. Okay, when you have a Quant Studio 3 system, it can detect 3 fluorescent dyes. There are few systems like Shy Bio, which is one of the company, it could detect only maximum 2 dyes simultaneously, 2 fluorescent dyes. Okay, so this is how it works, and we have 96 well plate, and you can perform real-time PCR on this machine. So what is the major difference between our conventional and real-time PCR is, so in the real-time PCR, like unlike conventional PCR where you are supposed to run the gel, and unless and until you run the gel, you don't know what is the result. So you are not sure whether the work has been proper, or you got the exact required size of bands, or your staining was not proper, then also you are not going to get the result. So there are so many factors which hinders our conventional PCR. So I'm not criticizing conventional PCR, but yeah, it is quite tedious as compared to real-time PCR, and obviously real-time PCR has a greater detection strength as compared to conventional PCR because of the limitation of ETBR and the detection limit of the detector, because we don't have detector as such in the conventional PCR unless and until you are looking out the image on the under the gel dock, which is a high resolution camera in terms of pixelation. So we'll not talk about details of gel dock over here, but with respect to real-time PCR, so why do we say it is as a real time? So at the end of, or somewhere around 80% completion of the result, so if your result is going to come as a positive for particular gene, then you are going to get something of this sort of graph for your target set of genes, and for so there will be some baseline also. So this is your reference gene. So if your target gene has been amplified like this, just so for example, so this is your target gene amplification. This is baseline gene or a fluorescent dye amplification. So there is a difference between the two, and this is positive control in the orange one. The pink one is your sample. So when you are running it with respect to positive control, and if you get the amplification somewhere around, say, these are number of cycles and these are fluorescent units on the y-axis, logarithmic obviously, and this is the number of cycles, say 1 2 20 25 30 35 40. Okay, so somewhere around, say, 25 cycles, you, so that is your cycling threshold value What is cycling threshold? I will explain that also. For your positive control, the cycling threshold is 23, and for your sample, the cycling threshold is, for example, 25. So there is a difference between two cities, but the graph is sigmoidal. When the graph is sigmoidal, then you say, okay, my positive control and my sample has worked, and this is in the acceptable CT value limit as per the kit instruction, if you are using a kit. Then your sample is positive. So this is how we detect our virus also. So currently what we are detecting is coronavirus. So what we perform in that, so we have a positive control for a coronavirus set of genes, say spike protein and nucleoprotein and ORF1, for example. So these get amplified and they give me a graph like this, sigmoidal graph of a positive control. Now I have my sample, and my sample gets amplified like this, okay, for the number of genes, and the CT value is within the limit for my positive control as well as for my sample, and graph is also proper. So in that case, my sample is positive for coronavirus. So this is how we use it for the interpretation, and this actually happens without running the gel. You don't have to run the gel. And this is like one of the application, but this is a qualitative PCR. So when I say qualitative real-time PCR, so it doesn't give you that cycling threshold is not going to signify your actual virus copy number. Okay, so CNV aapko nahi pata chalta hai. You will only come to know whether there is a presence of virus or there is an absence of virus. Okay, so this is how you can perform it in a real time. You don't have to run the gel, and you get to know by the picture, by looking at the graph simultaneously when the PCR is actually happening in the machine. Like I have shown you the diagram of Quant 5. So this is how you do it, and this is how you understand. That's why it is called as a real time PCR. Okay. Now we have various kinds of PCR. Okay, so in Cobas Amplicon analyzer, so I will not go into details, but I will just explain. So we have basically open end and closed end PCR machines. In case of open end, we have like Thermo, we have Takara, we have Ozone Bio, we have High Media, we have BioRad, we have Shai. Okay, so these are open end, few of the examples of open end. These are the few examples of closed end PCR. So when I say we have a closed end PCR, that means in case of closed end PCR, you need to use first of all the kit from the same company. That is the disadvantage of the closed end PCR. So your like nucleic acid extraction is going to occur in the cascade. For example, this is the cascade. So nucleic acid extraction will occur over here. You just add the sample with the whatever the prerequisite you need to perform on the sample, like dilution or breakage by using lysis buffer and everything. So nucleic acid extraction will occur, amplification will occur over here, and there will be detection part from the detector in the PCR itself, and you are going to get the result as a output, whether any gene is present or any gene is absent of those set of organisms or set of microorganisms. So that is a closed end PCR. So actually you are not going to extract DNA, so there is no DNA or RNA extraction. There is no step in which you are going to prepare a master mix and add it to your master mix preparation is no longer required in that. So that step is missing. Then you don't have to add your extracted DNA or RNA as a template. And you just perform. So you just add your sample over here in the cascade, and rest everything will be performed by the machine itself. And then you get the result in terms of positive and negative for the set of microorganisms. And it is possible to have a multiplexing. So in that case, you have a panel wise. So for a respiratory panel, neurodegenerative panel, hemolytic panel, and so on. So panel wise, identification of microorganisms, which could be fungal in origin, which could be bacterial or virus in origin. So that kind of stuff you can perform in a closed-end PCR. And but the thing is, it is very much costly. So it is not at all cost effective. For example, just an example to give you, for detection of set of, so whatever a panel they have designed, so that panel may not have the viruses which are present in your country itself, right, or in your region itself. So you don't want to check for those viruses because they are not going to be present, unlike there is some situation like a pandemic, like coronavirus, which has occurred. So you are not going to, like, it is not needed. So that's why rarest viruses and bacteria and fungals are also there in that panel, and that's why the cost becomes is also problematic thing, and it will be very much costly. But in case of our open end PCR, you perform everything. So you do extraction. So you perform the extraction by, say, silica column based method or magnetic beads based method extraction, or you can perform automated extraction of DNA or RNA. So that is the first step in a open end PCR. Now the second step, in which you prepare master mix. So there is separate altogether a video about conventional PCR and what is a master mix, how to prepare that, how to standardize the PCR reaction on my YouTube channel. So I will not go into details of that because that will take much more time. But master mix preparation is the step in which you add tag polymerase, DNTPs, and your template of, say, DNA and RNA over here, and you perform that master mix preparation. And the last step is a template addition room, where you add a template of your sample alone, and lastly of positive control. And then you put this plate or strips on a real-time PCR, and then you run it. So this is the open-end PCR. So advantage of open-end PCR is you can run it anytime, and it is cost effective. You can also perform multiplex in real time, like open end real time. In open end also, like whether you are performing any kind of real time PCR, close end or open end, you can do genotyping. You can do allelic discrimination. You can quantify. So quantification related PCR also you can perform. Then you can also do SNP deletion, SNP detection, single nucleotide polymorphism detection. You can also do homozygous or heterozygous deletion detection. Then you can do detect deletion events or deletion possibilities of the gene or the exons. So these many things you can do in the real time PCR when you are having open end model. So this was to give you idea about real time PCR. And so you add a probe. So there are various methods by which you can perform real time PCR. So just to give you a brief idea, we have a Tacman probe chemistry. We have a molecular beacon chemistry. Then we have fluorescence resonance energy transfer technology chemistry. So these are the variants under probe based real time PCR detection methods. Apart from that, you have a cybergrain related, but in case of ETBR and cybergrain modification methods, so we'll not talk about that detail, but these are the methods you have, probe based and signal based. Okay, so this was to give you a brief idea about real time PCR. So in the next lecture we are going to discuss about real time PCR in depth, how to go ahead with the quantitative part and how to go ahead with the detection part and future applications of real-time PCR and the remaining part of your nucleic acid hybridization methods which are related with the signaling and amplification part and ligation part. So far clear?
Yes sir.
Okay, anyone has anyone has any doubts?
No sir.
Okay, so
no sir.
So I will just take the attendance and then we can stop for today. Fine.
Yes, sir.
So if you have any doubts, any point of time, now you can just send it to Alia or you can mail me also on my email ID. Okay. That is my email ID, samantalalit@gmail.com. Okay, so whatever doubts you have regarding your topic, I can always explain that to you. So whenever you have any doubt or you have any difficulty, whenever you are studying any part of your syllabus related to topics which I am teaching, you can always ask me. There is no problem in that. Okay.
Yes.